A young LP discovers the late Jeff Buckley, who inspires them to pursue their dreams of becoming a singer and songwriter.
I think Jeff Buckley was a turning point in my heart about being a fan. I never knew that level of love for someone and their work before. It was like, oh shit, I can care this deeply about someone's work. I know how hard it hit me when I lost Jeff Buckley.
On with us. Thanks so much for joining.
Thank you, man. I'm excited.
We always start sort of at the beginning of your childhood. And so tell us where you grew up, sort of, and then when you first discovered music, what was it?
You know, it was like very young, Brooklyn, and moved to Long Island. And then my parents split up. I was in Manhattan. And I didn't grow up in a family that they put a lot of music on. But my mom was always singing opera or listening to old musical theater shit. And my brother liked classic rock. Like, I probably wouldn't have heard Ozzy Osbourne and shit. And then, you know, the 90s of, like, I loved when grunge came out and, like, kind of stopped all that metal shit, which I like some of it, you know, some really good songs. But it was just, like, the gentle age of men, which was welcome.
Where was it where you realized that you wanted to maybe pursue music, or you had a talent that you actually thought, I could do this for a living?
Oh, I mean, I was probably, by the time I was 20, that's when I decided I could maybe do something, you know? I didn't grow up in that kind of family, and it was, like, not encouraged to go into entertainment. I mean, my father's exact words, like, where you can't make any money in entertainment. And I won't say it, but I will say it. I do better than him, you know? So I did what I loved, and I didn't know that you could do it. It wasn't just really, like, what am I going to do with my life? It's like, am I going to pursue something that I love or not? You know, like, there's a real stigma in, like, a academic family for you to go, yeah, I'm going to be a musician. Nobody gets it. You know, they're like, it's like a lottery ticket.
Wanting to go into music and wanting to pursue it is one thing. Having the talent to actually succeed at it and be at the level you are is something completely different. So there had to be something along the way that you realized in high school or.
Well, I saw the effect that when I sang, it had on people. And when my mom passed away when I was, like, a teenager, I was very disillusioned with, like, she was, like, 45 years old. It was like, what is the point? You know, like, she did a great service to my life. She really, really put so much love and care and education into me. And it has informed much of my life, you know, so I'm very grateful. But at the end of the day, I felt like she never got to really live her own life, you know, so I had to, like, think about that. I was just very hell-bent on, all of a sudden, I'm doing something that felt good to me, you know? And when I sing, I feel like that's the main thing that people are like, oh, shit, you know? But I had to undo years of conditioning and programming to go, so you should do that, you know? Because it's like still, like, people are like, no. And then I had no idea how to go about it, you know? And I was like, oh, shit, you know? It is hard. And, it, you know, I did go through many dark nights of the soul thinking, ah, shit, did I just, like, kind of work at getting good at something, like, I'm never going to get to do? I don't know. But I just went, like, really, really hard. And I kept working on it. I kept working on my voice, on my songwriting. But coming out the other side of it, holy shit, it was worth it. I was right.
That's amazing because, again, you had the passion, the drive to pursue it, and then not everybody makes it. So it sounds like the death of your mom sort of changed you in a profound way, and it made you sort of question, what is life worth and how do I want to spend it?
Yeah, like, she basically left my father and then had her own life for a year and then found out she had cancer and then died, you know? So it was like a scramble at the end just to, like, carve out a little fucking piece of her own life. And so I'm living this one for her and for me, you know what I mean? And I think she can, you know, feel me and see me. And she's like, fuck yeah. But I was very lucky as well. You know, like, that song Lost on You, I've told the story countless times about, I was in debt $1.6 million to Warner Brothers. And I played them that song and two other songs that have made me so much money. And they dropped me, you know. If I stayed on Warner Brothers, I wouldn't be sitting here because they would have fucking kept Lost on You. In fact, Rihanna was looking at Lost in You. She probably would have fucking cut it. You know, like, my whole life would have been different. That's the lucky part. Because I think about people that have, like, a Lost in You or something sitting on their computer with nothing to show for it, you know?
Well, I always say it's luck, talent, timing.
Preparation meets opportunity. Yeah.
Well, congrats. You've done it. That is a very rare thing that you've achieved. So I want to take kudos to
Thanks,
you.
Man.
I was going to say also, just because it's very relatable, and if Olivia had been on, she would have loved to have talked to you. She lost her mom last year at this time.
I'm sorry.
And so she's 21 when she lost her mom. You were a teenager, pretty close.
Yeah, it was like 18.
And so I completely relate. I'm so sorry that you went through that. And I know the lessons are really painful, but there's something in there that you take from it, and it forms who you are.
Yeah. You know, everybody's got their things they got to go through. Also, you know, when I think about sometimes if my mother was alive, I might not be sitting here either, because I feel like she would have been so involved in like my decisions, and you know, she might have like not talked me into, because I don't think she's not that kind of person, but we would have talked together about like, all right, well, maybe go back to school. I don't know. Like, who the fuck knows? You know what I mean? I was just like, do or die, man. It's like, you know, I didn't have any guidance like that. I had to listen to my fucking soul.
In those years when you started to realize music was a true passion, what were some of the artists who were really influenced who you became?
It was a constant, you know, rotation, especially on the singing tip. You know what I mean? I was like listening to Aretha Franklin, Chaka Khan, Joni Mitchell, Pat Benatar, you know, kind of like shit like that. And then like a vocalist like Kurt Cobain kind of blew my mind, especially as a songwriter, obviously. But even just that tone, I mean, Green Day, you know, like Billy Joel like taught me how to like kind of press on the tone. And, you know, I think singers, you know, they start becoming who they are, and they start liking certain people because they can kind of emulate them well, you know. And it's fun to go from, oh, you kind of sound like this, you kind of sound like that, you kind of sound like this, to like, you don't sound like anybody at all.
We all are influenced by so many different artists, and they fuel different parts of your style and your brain, from the hard rock to the real reality to the Broadway. I mean, I think that's probably where it just becomes a sponge as a young person.
Yeah. And they all start mixing together, and then suddenly your original thing that like filtered through all this other shit, you know? That's the biggest thing, you know, like when I was writing songs for other people and stuff, and I worked with a lot of young people that were like filtered through the system, you know? And like, I think almost it gave me the courage to go back to being an artist again in a way. I might seem like I knew I was going to go back to being an artist. I had no fucking idea. And then all of a sudden, 2011, it's like I was writing all these songs because I was like, I just started having fun doing it again, because I was playing ukulele and it was like I had nothing to lose. Suddenly I was getting signed to Warner Brothers as an artist again. And I was like, oh shit, wow. But that, I was going to say, what gave me courage is like I saw all these like people go through the system that were like, you know, way better looking, younger, and fucking, in my opinion, as good or better vocalists than me. And guess what? Record didn't come out, only got dropped like 95% of the time. But it just gave me pause to go like, oh shit, this is a very tough business, even with everything, you know? And it's really funny, like how even fans and the general public treat artists sometimes as if like, it's so judgy. Oh, well, you're not this, or you're not that, or they didn't do this. You know how fucking hard it is? Or like, you know, when like Justin Bieber came out, and it's like, oh, he made it because of this and that. Motherfucker was talented and he worked really hard. He had to. And people have no idea what goes into like a song even getting played on the radio. You know, I remember like when I first started blowing up in Europe, some people were treating it like, oh yeah, you're big in Europe, as if that's like a booby prize or some shit. You know, like, oh yeah, you know, in Europe where they don't listen to anything. It's like, okay. Sure. It's like a bunch of actual people on the other side of the world, discerning people. They don't give a shit. No, it's just, you know, they have different tastes.
Like you said, anyone that's listening to your song on the radio is more than 99% of the people ever get in this lifetime. Congrats to you.
And that's the thing. And that's where I'm very aware and very grateful. You know, I had a friend of a girl I was dating at the time. This prick says to me, the second time he's ever met me, he goes, why do you think bigger outside the country than in this country? And I said, you know, Big Apple, whatever the fuck your name is, I don't know. But I do know that I'm as bigger than I ever hoped to be in this country, and I'm very grateful for it. And but I hope that I aspire to get as big as you need me to be in this country. And that's like something I like, I invite it. I love it. Because only I know really how lucky I am. And I address it every day. I was given this gift to do this with my life. So I try to honor it by like continuing to make records.
No, I think a lot of people lose appreciation or gratitude. And that's the key.
Yeah, you got to be careful with that because it makes it unpleasant for you. Like, you know, why you put all this work into doing this and then you're going to dishonor it. It's like one of the biggest things I felt after like the first record that got really big for me and like really took me around the world. I felt this wave of responsibility. Like I had to make a fucking another record for people.
I wanted to get into now a couple of the key musical influences and moments in your life. So I want to start with, you become a songwriter and you end up writing songs for some really huge artists, Rihanna, Backstreet Boys, Christina Aguilera. Looking up to these people, you know, when you're thinking and dreaming about being a star or being a musician or having your music out there, what's that moment like when you're working with Rihanna or Christina Aguilera?
You know, the first song really that got a cut was the Backstreet Boys track, and I had written that. It's called Love Will Keep You Up All Night. And that was the year my father died, actually. I got a call that he died right after I wrote that song. And I remember, like, I was writing it for myself, and that record deal didn't work out. And I remember the Backstreet Boys doing it, and I was like, wow, that's so weird. It's not something you can't decide. One day you're all alone, the next you're crying on the phone. I'm gonna keep you out of my mind. You gotta taste the sweet divine. And like, it was a watershed moment for me because I was like, oh shit, that's possible. A big artist could sing your song. Suddenly 2009, I signed a publishing deal and just embarked on this songwriting journey where I was just like, I really hustled. I like did 2 sessions a day every fucking day, but I just was like grateful to be like, so now I'm writing songs for other people. And I thought, what an irony. I'm like, I couldn't write a song for myself. Like, I didn't have the song. Like, the majors put me in all these directions. Like, oh, you should be a rock chick. Oh, a pop chick. Oh, real country. You know. And then all of a sudden, I'm like a sought-after songwriter. I was like, this is weird. You know? So then that took me on this journey where I was like writing like more pop, like urban-y kind of songs. You know? Then I started getting in those rooms. And all that shit came and informed my artist career again because I think that that was one of the problems without me getting going is because I'm kind of don't like, I have a very blurry genre. If you heard my records, I don't know. How would you describe what genre am I?
It varies. Yeah. Like you said, sometimes like, you know, rock or pop or.
And I'm allowed to for some reason, like, it's expected of me anyway. And I don't have to, you know, I mean, maybe it's still a problem with US radio or whatever the fuck. I really don't care, but I don't really adhere to any genre. And I think that's popular now in, you know, with a lot of artists, even in the beginning, because, you know, when you're first writing a song, you have to be free, you know, and let it go where it needs to go or not go where it needs to go. Like, I think one of the things I've gotten much better at as I'm writing, I can feel like myself self-editing, but not in a limiting way where I'm just like stopping an idea from coming to fruition or stopping a good thing. Because I let things go as far as I can until it's like, yeah, this is too far out, you know? Mm-hmm. But I can really kind of like slice and dice as I go along. It's nice. It's like something I picked up on the way through a lot of tries.
When you hear a Rihanna doing your song or Christina Aguilera, take me through what goes through your mind as the kid from New York who would dream about, you know, a famous musician doing one of their songs.
I mean, it was mind-blowing. I mean, especially like the Rihanna one was a real big one because I was just like kind of surprised that she didn't really change much. You know, it definitely was Rihanna, but I didn't know, I thought the whole fucking song was going to change, but she just basically sang what I sang in the demo, you know, Rihanna-fied it in a really beautiful way. I love her voice. I love her style. So, but I was just like surprised and just like, oh shit. Yeah, it felt really good. Damn, it's an honor. Like Celine Dion did one of my songs on her last record and you know, that was pretty cool. And I remember she was talking about me in a bunch of interviews that she wanted to meet me, she wanted to write something, you know, and then she took one of my already existing songs. And I know why she took it, because it had this big modulation at the end. Yeah, it was just fun to hear this incredibly lauded singer rocking my show.
Have you met some of the folks that you wrote these songs for eventually and sort of had that moment of like, were you face to face?
No, not really, no. In fact, I had some funny story from one of my mentors, like Billy Steinberg, this huge writer. And he tells me this story about like, because, you know, he wrote Like a Virgin for Madonna. And, you know, and she had done a whole like virgin tour, like a virgin tour. And like, you know, it was like she built an entire, it's a big pillar of her whole career, if you look at it, for sure. You know, you could rarely get tickets to the show. It was amazing. He said, I thought she was going to go, oh my God.
Right. Thank you.
Like she tried to scoot past him and his partner, and he felt not at all welcome. Then it's like, you're ruining the facade.
Right. And probably doesn't want anybody to know that it wasn't hers.
Yeah. I mean, it's hard. You know, it's like, that's a hard pill to swallow. You're like, oh, I thought it was going to be like this. Nope. You know, you just like, you let it take the credit. You know, I'm a generous person. I split everything. And I don't care all somebody did during a session is smile. They get an equal percentage.
That's the way it should be.
Yeah, man. It comes back.
I want to talk about specifically a couple of artists that were sort of, I call them your sonic impacts. One was Jeff Buckley. Now, I listened to Jeff Buckley when I was younger, and I remember his voice was operatic. It was sort of like angelic. Never heard anything like it. And then for those who don't know, he died in a river, as I recall. Sad story. But tell me about when you discovered Jeff Buckley and what kind of an impact he had on your music style and life.
I don't remember who exactly turned me on to him. I think I just discovered him myself, you know, in a record store or some shit, you know, like when we still had that shit at Tower Records where you could go in and listen to people. And, you know, I'll always like, as a big fucking queer ass motherfucker as I am, I'm like, you know, I still can like see a beautiful man and go, oh shit, what's that guy doing? Or someone that looks cool, you know? But yeah, I remember seeing a picture of him and going like, who's this handsome bastard? You know? And then I saw his music and I was like, oh shit. And, the record company did not want him to wear that weird, sparkly blazer that he had on. Like it doesn't fit the music or whatever. And he kind of didn't in a way. But then when you got to like, you know, see any interviews and see what a fucking weirdo he was in the best way, you know, you're like, oh shit, right. You know, his voice just immediately, I think probably the first song I must have heard was Mojo Pin. And just the way, the execution, the attack of the voice, like that's a big thing, I think, with voices for me. You know, having said that, I think that's why Celine Dion zoomed in on my shit, because of one of the qualities of my voice is how I attack shit, like go dead in on the note, you know. And I think that's another unique thing that all different singers have. And I loved his attack. I loved how he rode this emotional train so fucking cool, you know, like from that, like you said, that angelic shit to then the screaming, crying, fucking wailing shit. Sometimes a man gets carried away. He feels like he should be having his fun. The mind's too blind to see the damage he's done. Sometimes a man must wait to find a Billy who has no one. So I wait. Yeah, and it was really, really hot, very sexy, very like that. That was the thing that was cool. It's like he could be like whiny, but it was sexy, and it was, and there was a darkness there, but it was like he was like an archangel or something like that. You know what I mean? It just felt like he was fucking surfing the fucking line of heaven and hell the whole time, trying to, you know, and bringing it to us just so viscerally. And he was like pounding it all into this fucking 3 or 4 minute, I see it as like a pop song, a catchy pop song, even though it's like rock, you know. There was just so much. So I was really, you know, it's very sad to have lost him. It's such a beautiful fucking place that he was with his writing and everything, and where he was going to go from there. I think it would have been something to, it would have been something to behold. I love that he was able to be, you know, the only person since Freddie Mercury that was able to be like rock and roll, opera, you know, and I've worked it into my own thing.
What I also think about Jeff Buckley, his range, when you listen to the notes he could hit, which is also with you, your range is out of this world. I don't know where that comes from. I'm a singer for fun, but I don't know how some singers can hit those notes that are just, like you said, angelic, heavenly, whatever you want to call it, from another world.
I think it's like goes to the thing where like you're trying to, on an instrument, playing whatever you hear. I just feel like I always want to go higher and higher. And I think Jeff Buckley really did it well and very uniquely. And we didn't even have enough time with him to like kind of, because as much as everybody knows Jeff Buckley, there's a lot of people who don't know Jeff Buckley.
Well, I was going to say, most people who know Jeff Buckley know his version of Hallelujah, which, by the way,
yeah,
you know, it's now been used, overused by everyone. But when you go back and listen to Buckley's version, I don't think there's anyone's who comes close to it.
Yeah. It was just a inspired cover, too. I mean, you know, everybody covers it now, whatever. But like Leonard Cohen's version is fucking incredible, man. But just the fact that Jeff Buckley would do that song is
right.
Fucking ridiculous.
Right. It's like a lot of people don't realize that if you went back and listened to Leonard Cohen's version, no one would have thought, let's make this song and do a cover. And it becomes like iconic.
Also, like he had to like, there's like 15 fucking verses to Leonard Cohen's.
Right.
The ones he picked. I'm watching this actually Leonard Cohen Hallelujah documentary, which is like, I'm only 20 minutes in. I think it's like 2 hours long, but it's pretty enthralling already.
So I want to just hone in a little bit more on Buckley. What year was it when you discovered him, and where were you in your musical career? And most importantly, what impact did it have? Did it make you, I want to pursue this, or were you already a musician and were like, holy crap?
I was like toying with it, but no, like when he died, I was really, all right, I'm going to, you know, do it, you know, but I was, yeah, playing in a band already, but like, you know, kind of not sure. I was a really inexperienced songwriter, obviously, so I hadn't really gone there yet. So it was also really cool to hear these songs that were like kind of hard to pin down. I don't know if anybody knew where to put Jeff Buckley right away, you know? It was kind of indie at the time, no?
It seems like maybe what it inspired you was to not be pigeonholed. Like you heard a guy who could sing any style, like,
yes.
And you're like, that's
the thing.
Guy.
Yeah, it wasn't like something you had to know. That's what I liked about it. He inspired me not to care about how people are going to receive shit. You know, and I still don't.
For people who don't know Jeff's music, because like you said, some people may not even know him. What are a couple of iconic or really important songs for you and your career, what they should listen to?
I mean, So Real is like a really big one. And Grace for sure, Mojo Pin. That whole record of Grace is insane.
Oh, if only you come back to me, feel it at my side. Wouldn't need no Mojo Pin to keep me satisfied.
Live at Chennai is crazy. And that place was like a few blocks from my house. And I remember like being out on the street talking about how there was like lines down the block. When you hear that record, it's just so, that's another thing, not to mention he's a great guitar player. There's not many people who can play and sing like that. When you see live versions, all the songs from Grace live, it's fucking insanity. When Jeff Buckley's record, the posthumous record, came out, and I remember I was in, you know, New York City, and I was like, I bought it. I just remember feeling sick to my stomach. I just was like, he would have never let this out like this, because he poured over Grace and like so meticulous. And he would have never let these songs out like that. But that was all we had. So it had to be something. But I was just thinking to myself, and then after this, that's it. Nothing more from Jeff Buckley for the rest of my fucking life. Holy fucking shit. That sucks.
Well, I encourage everyone to go listen to Grace, because most people have probably not listened to it fully.
Listen to it and go on a deep dive on YouTube to see live versions of it. And look at this beautiful fucking guy who's amazing at guitar, who's just absolutely lost in this song. Like, he looks like he's gonna, like I said, he looks like he's surfing down like the fucking line of fucking heaven and hell, like just screaming the whole way. It's so insane. Yeah. It's out of control.
You know, LP, this is what this podcast is all about. It's about the artists that inspired you and your life and your career. You know, we've done a lot of people who aren't musicians as well. But when you have someone like yourself who can look back and go, you know, what would my life be if I hadn't discovered Jeff Buckley? It might have been, you know, a different path. It might have been sort of a different choices that I made. So if you can sort of sum up what you think Jeff Buckley's impact on your career and life has been.
For one, through his death, the fragility of not just a life, but like of a body of work, and how precious that is. The fact that I was saying I can never hear more songs from this person again. I think Jeff Buckley was a turning point in my heart about being a fan. I never knew that level of love for someone and their work before, but it's like, I need that, you know, like as life goes on, like I'm a big, like classic rock. Like I said, Beatles and the Stones, I need them like air and water, you know, but it's funny, as I get older, I feel like, all right, well, if it was like some Sophie's Choice bullshit where you're like, you know, between like the Beatles and the Stones, I don't think I can live without the Stones. I think when Keith Richards dies, I don't have a hard time. Like, I'm just going to be like, I don't know life without him walking the earth, you know? But like, I think like Jeff Buckley for me, you know, generationally, I just was like, oh shit, I can care this deeply about someone's work. And that played into like wanting to like do that and maybe be, you know, and they say it to me a lot. And my music got them through something, or they listen to it every day. And I'm like, how cool is it that it's someone I don't even know that like knows me from my work? And, you know, I just like, I feel very responsible. Keep giving them more. So yeah, it's a gift to be able to do that. And I know how hard it hit me when I lost that with Jeff Buckley. So I just don't want to do that.
You know, and you bring up a point for people who grew up before the internet, for social media. The connection with the artist was obviously different. You know, now you see them, you hear them, you follow them, you can connect with them even. But back then it was mystery, like Jeff Buckley or...
Good old days. Like I got this kid right now who's like, who said some like nasty shit. I was like, who is this person? But then I go in there, this kid, like I see the messages and it just says, oh, I love you, I love you, I love you, OP. I want to come see you. And then all of a sudden, you only care about five people. You fucking suck. I hate you. I hate you. Like all this, like, and then like, and I was thinking to myself, wow, I can't imagine holding Jeff Buckley to that standard and being like, you know, or I'll have people go like, hey, you haven't liked one of my posts in a while. Are we okay? So that access is very weird. And I was never an artist before it. So, but yeah, that mystery, that's nice.
There was a distance between you and the artist. They were more godlike, I think, because you're like, you just can't imagine even ever meeting them.
And you know what? I will tell people all the time, it's like, you don't know shit. You know? My life is like, you know, I keep it tight. You know, my first relationship on the social media thing, it took me by surprise and got all the way out there. And then, you know, everybody had their opinion about things. And now, like, you know, I'm sure everybody experiences this and try to keep things like kind of like, and yeah, you might be seeing what you think you're seeing. So what? It's my fucking business. You know, I don't come up to your fucking house and go, ding dong, I like that other guy you were dating before this.
Right, right. Well, they have no idea what it'd be like to be judged and looked at. It's one of those things. It's the pros and cons of fame, right?
You know, but it's really nice to like, you know, that mystery of Jeff Buckley, like fucking, I love that.
I want to sort of bring, I like to sort of bring, you know, threads in. And so we talked about your mom dying at a very young age, which was life altering. And your father died. So you've dealt with grief and death a lot in your life, two of the most important people in your life. And Jeff Buckley, your artist that we chose, also died. I just wanted to talk a little bit about grief for you and grief you use in your music and music that helped you through grief.
Yeah, I mean, like my songs, oftentimes, especially positive ones, are sometimes just me trying to pull myself out of a dark place, you know? And I don't know, you know, the way I process grief, I think it's like kind of a pain threshold or something like that, which apparently has a high one, you know? But yeah, I think that, I don't know, sometimes I don't think I know how important like music is to me, you know, not only outside music, but my own, you know? It's a real source of comfort and expression. and I'm trying to like make sense of my life through it. Like, you know, I imagine many artists do, I guess. I feel so lucky to have even been like kind of aware enough to go, oh, well, maybe I'll do this with my life. Because I like meet people that are like so disillusioned after 40, like they didn't do what they wanted to do with their lives. Even with like a relationship, you know, when I broke up with my first love and like moved to California, you know, like, a lot of times people get older and go, I wonder what would happen if I fucking left whoever and went to California. And I'm like living that other side and I'm very aware of it. And it's like, you know, I'm very grateful for it. It's really interesting. And I, you know, and I try to like, I mean, that's a deep topic. I guess, you know, I kind of feel like a lot of my music is like exploring that sometimes, like, you know, and just delving into the immensity of decisions and feelings, you know, because they mean everything, you know?
Not everyone loses a parent young. Not everybody loses two parents young. And then, you know, an artist in their life that is one of the biggest influences dies young.
Yeah.
You know, people deal with grief in different ways, but it seems like that loss has fueled something deep in you as a songwriter, as a person. You said your inspiration to achieve because your mom.
And, you know, for me, God comes into it a lot. You know, I'm very close with God. You know, I really, you know, honor that like reception of music from them into my life. And it helps me make sense of everything. My goal here is to try to make people feel better, safer, more loved. And that's it. Yeah. I'm just like, I'm just a, you know, flawed human being, but I get to do this and I take it pretty seriously, you know,
and
not seriously at all because, you know, it's got to be fun.
We're all flawed human beings, right? We're just trying to improve ourselves and along the way.
Yeah.
I had a couple more questions then I'm going to let you go because you've been really gracious with your time and I really love talking
to
you.
My pleasure. You too.
I wanted to ask you about one of your managers mentioned Cyndi Lauper. And so, you know, we talk about Jeff Buckley as your sort of main sonic impact, but there are other people. And I guess you met Cyndi. So I wanted to hear about sort of your journey with Cyndi, where you discovered her and sort of how that played out.
I mean, you know, she's like definitely a vocal powerhouse, like amazing vocalist and songwriter and a character and a half. You know, we wrote a song that never came out. I really liked the song. And it was just like, it was very trippy to be like writing this song with her. She had her dulcimer out. And I remember like we were listening to the song after it was done and she just like, she turns around and it was so surreal. I think I have it in my iPad somewhere in our session. She just turns around, she goes, this song is so sad. It's so sad. And I was like, it is kind of sad. And, but we were writing the words. It was fun. We were walking around the streets around the studio trying to ink of lyrics and shit. And we wound up going to that bar Four of Clubs or something like that. But yeah, and she was telling me about her life and a lot of, you know, fucked up shit that happened in her life and how like she came out of it and how what got her into music. And it was really, really beautiful to hear and just so like surreal, you know, like I don't think I've ever had like, you know, a deeper conversation with that level of artist, you know. I mean, I talked to some big people, but like we kind of went deep, you know, writing a song together. And it's so cool.
That's intense. And you're also a fellow New Yorker, so that's got to help too.
Yeah.
But I mean, growing up, Cyndi Lauper was such an iconic MTV star. That song, a bunch of her songs.
Like,
is anything better for a young woman than Girls Just Want to Have Fun? Like, it's just such an upbeat, fun song.
And the way she carried herself too was like, you know, she wasn't conventionally beautiful. Like, you know, she came up around Madonna and there was definitely a, like the difference, obviously, and then they went on vastly different paths. But, you know, she's a strong woman, you know. So is Madonna, obviously. But I'm just saying, she very much her own thing. And that's always like uniqueness and authenticity. Nothing to shake a stick at, you know. It doesn't happen every day. There's nothing if not that. So, you know, I mean, I think that she's inspiring. She always has been.
I had to ask, my daughter has gotten on me in the past, Dad, we need more diverse guests on this show. We need more people of color. We need more diversity, gender. So I have to ask for Olivia, for also for myself, being a queer ass motherfucker, as you said, as an artist today, it must be much different than it would have been 20, 30 years ago. So give us a little insight on, you know, how the world has changed in the music business.
I mean, I think if like one thing that's really, really obvious is like, you know, you can have one other woman in a band, in your band, without it being a girl band. God, I don't hear that term anymore. In fact, everyone's like, you know, Olivia Rodrigo, she's all girls in her band. You know what I mean? And it's incredible. But like, you don't go like, oh, girl band. I mean, it's been, you know, a minute with that. But like now it's like, it's becoming de rigueur for like bands and not even being like booed and awed at, which is like really nice, you know? You know, you talk about being gay, being queer, whatever, you know, like, I mean, is that not besides the point right about now? It's like, I mean, obviously, I'm a fucking lesbian. We don't have to talk about that ever again. You know, it's like, I'm gonna fuck who you fuck, you know, the normal. And it's just like, we move on from that. It's just like, it's I think it's getting more and more like that. It's beautiful.
Last thing I wanted to ask you is about your new album.
My new album, Love Lines, is a walk down romance lane. Past loves, present loves, future loves. Drugs, sex, rock and roll. I think that's one of my favorite records I've ever done, I would be honest with you. So I hope people like it. If you don't like it, you know, I'm already percolating with more.
Don't go on Instagram or wherever and DM you about what you don't like about it.
Yeah, just, you know what I mean? Like, I should have, like, you know those direct the emails that go, like, I'm out of town right now?
Yeah.
Mine's just going to be say, like, hey, that's great. Go fuck yourself.
Well, on that note, go fuck yourself. I hope you don't say that to me and coming
hell
on the show.
No. If you don't, or you know, or we could go super like cute and Bambi on it. Where it's like, if you can't say something nice, don't say nothing at all.
Exactly. Well,
Thumper,
I wish you all the best with the album. Everybody checking out Love Lines. When's it coming out?
Thanks, Elliot. It's coming out September 29th.
Nice. So it's like on the cusp of Virgo. What's like comes out for Virgo?
Oh yeah. What sign is my record?
After
September 29th. It's a Libra. My record's a Libra.
Yeah.
I think that's perfect. That's really fun. I'm going to call my record a Libra. I'm a Libra rising.
We wrote something on this podcast together.
We did. We wrote something. My new album, Love Lines, which will be out September 29th, is a Libra. It likes long walks in the sun, lots of balance, and all that kind of shit.
You can use that in all your interviews if you want.
Hey, by the way, tell Olivia that anytime she wants to fucking talk,
she will take you up on it.
Hell yeah. No, when she comes to the show, come backstage.
Yeah.
We'll have a chat.
I'll find out if you're going to Boston or she'll come to New York. But she was really bummed to miss you, and she was so happy you're coming on. I sent her your message, so she sends peace, and thank you so much for doing this.
I look forward to having a nice chat with her at some point.
Oh, you'd make her year.
Thank you very much.
Thanks for
a really good time.
Thanks for coming on, LP.
All right, hell yeah. See ya. Bye.